Hi everyone. Today we're going to be talking about biomineralization again. This is the part 4 biomineralization video in which we're talking about biologically controlled mineralization, which is where I think it gets really, really cool, guys. We talked about biologically induced mineralization processes as well as the mineral examples in the previous few videos, but this video we're going to be talking about biologically controlled mineralization. Again, there are two main types of biomineralization, induced and controlled, that we introduced in the first video. And again, controlled just means that the microbe or organism that's contributing to that process is not only contributing passively, but it's actually actively controlling both the nucleation and the growth mechanisms of that process. And typically this is done by microbes that have an intra or intracellular site or locus of mineralization where they sequester ions into, and then once they concentrate enough ions in that site or locus of mineralization, they then can expose the ions that they sequestered to certain organic ligands that might facilitate the nucleation of minerals and then grow those minerals by just sequestering more ions and just piling on to the mineral growth that has already begun. But this is just a general explanation of the process, and there are many intricate details depending on which mineral and which controlled process we're talking about that we're going to go over today when we go over examples: magnetite, greigite, and amorphous silica. We aren't going to touch on calcite or fossilization processes just yet, but we'll talk about those in the next video. So in the part 2 biomineralization video, we actually discussed magnetite already. However, we discussed it regarding its biologically induced formation rather than its biologically controlled mineralization. This is very different than its induced mineralization. Actually, instead of passively contributing to the magnetite formation by reducing iron 3 to iron 2, the bacteria involved in this process, called magnetotactic bacteria, control magnetite formation within their cell intracellularly. We can actually see this in this picture here, which I think is so cool, which is why I included it as the thumbnail picture. They form these chains of magnetite that align with magnetic fields in their cell and therefore can align themselves along magnetic field lines, which I'm getting ahead of myself, but it's so cool. And all members of this group of bacteria share some similarities. These three main similarities include that they are typically microaerophilic, meaning they only like oxygen concentrations to a certain level. Like, they could not live at atmospheric oxygen concentrations. That's too much for them. But they also couldn't live at too low of oxygen concentrations. So they're aerophilic, but microly aerophilic. And they're also bidirectional typically, so they can move in two different directions. And lastly, they contain magnetosomes. Magnetosomes are intracellular membrane-bound structures that house magnetite grains. And most of these bacteria contain around 20 magnetosomes in their cell. That's a lot. But some contain as much as 1,000 magnetosomes. And magnetite crystals in these bacteria have different morphologies than those formed passively just by iron-reducing bacteria producing iron 2. In fact, they have controlled morphologies that are always either cubic, rectangular, or arrow-shaped, and they are free from crystallographic imperfections and very pure magnetite or iron 304, which is pretty crazy because it basically implies that these bacteria have the ability to weed out possible contaminant ions that might impurify their magnetite. They have the ability to make really, really pure and pretty much crystallographically perfect magnetite crystals, which is insane. And their magnetite grain sizes range from around 35 to 120 nanometers. And I put here that they retain their magnetic behavior. I put this because in that part 2 video, when we talked about biologically induced magnetite formation, we talked about how a lot of the grain sizes of that type of magnetite can be less than 30 nanometers, meaning that it loses its magnetic behavior at that size, whereas the magnetite formed by this controlled process does not lose its magnetic behavior, so they can still utilize the magneticism of their magnetite that they form in their cell. And I don't know if magneticism is a word now that I think about it, but I'm saying it and you know what I mean. So by using this magnetic behavior of their magnetite, the bacteria can align themselves along geomagnetic fields field lines like a compass needle while they swim. And in terms of where they live in environments near or at the anoxic to oxic interface. And they typically use oxygen or nitrate as an electron acceptor, or TAE, terminal electron acceptor. But they've also been shown to be able to use iron 3, nitrous oxide, or even sulfate, but this isn't shown to be as common. In fact, they seem to grow the most magnetite when using nitrate as a terminal electron acceptor. However, they always seem to require at least 1% oxygen for magnetite synthesis. And we'll talk about why this might be in a couple slides. First though, let's ask ourselves why these bacteria actually need magnetic properties. Are there evolutionary advantages? Why would they have evolved such a weird capability? Well, much of the research around this topic is speculation, but it's speculated that magnetotaxis for navigation is a possible reason that these bacteria might have evolved this property. It means that the cell's ability to align itself along geomagnetic field lines and basically know which way is up can be very important for the environment in which they live. Because we just talked about how they're microaerophilic, meaning they don't like atmospheric oxygen levels, but they still like a little bit of oxygen, this means that where they are in terms of up and down in their environment really matters. Because they live at that oxic-anoxic interface, they want to make sure they stay there. They don't want to go too far above this interface because they'll get too much oxygen, and they don't want to go too far below this interface because they'll have too little oxygen. However, this reasoning is a little complicated, because if this was the case, why wouldn't all bacteria in these suboxic environments have these properties? And why do these magnetotactic bacteria still produce magnetite at the equator where the magnetic field lines are horizontal? So the why is not completely resolved, as you can tell. But we do know a little bit more about the how. Magnetite production in these bacteria happens in steps. The first step is the uptake of iron 3 by organic iron chelators, or iron grabbers, that the cell employs and sends out to the external environment to grab this iron. These iron chelators, or iron grabbers, are called siderophores, and they help to dissolve and transport the iron 3 into the cell. To do this, specific receptor and transport proteins typically guide the iron 3 siderophore complex to the plasma membrane, where the siderophore can then do one of two things. In some bacteria, the siderophore then passes off the iron 3 to a membrane-bound chelator that then takes it into the cell, or the siderophore can continue holding on to that iron 3 and take it all the way into the cell. It just depends on the bacteria. Regardless, once the iron is in the cell, the iron 3 is reduced to iron 2, ferrous iron, and it is shuttled to the magnetosome, or one of their many magnetosomes. In the magnetosome, the iron 2 is reoxidized to ferric hydroxide by oxygen, which is probably why they needed that at least 1% oxygen to synthesize magnetite. Then the reaction with ferric hydroxide and the remaining iron 2, or the continued stream of iron 2 coming in, produces the magnetite. We can see an animation of this down here to the bottom left. We can see the inner part of a magnetotactic bacterium. The blue is the inner edges of their membrane, whereas the yellow are the magnetosomes that we can see host magnetite forming, and then the magnetite starts to form these chains like we can see in the actual bacterium picture to the right that align along geomagnetic field lines. And this magnetite biosynthesis is not that far off from the biologically controlled greigite formation. Greigite particles are membrane bound and form into chains as well. And even though greigite, or iron 3S4, is only 1/3 as magnetic as magnetite, it still ferromagnetically aligns its chains of greigite grains. This is probably because the lower magnetism of the greigite mineral is compensated by the fact that greigite producing bacteria have a much greater abundance of magnetosomes than the magnetactic bacteria. And the morphologies of greigite crystals formed in this way are typically cuboidal and rectangular prismatic, and they range in size from 30 to 120 nanometers. And like we mentioned, the magnetotactic bacteria like to live at the oxic-anoxic interface, and they don't want to go anywhere above or below that. However, greigite-producing bacteria like to live below the oxic to anoxic interface, where sulfide concentrations are high, because they need that sulfide to produce their iron 3S4 mineral rather than the magnetite, which is an iron 3 oxygen 4 mineral. So moving on from magnetite and greigite to amorphous silica now. As cool as the magnetite and greigite producing bacteria are, I have to give it to the amorphous silica producers. They are so cool. So get ready for a world of coolness with these guys. Basically, we talked in the biomineralization part 2 video about passively biomineralized amorphous silica, but in this video we'll talk about how this process can be controlled by some eukaryotes. These eukaryotes include radiolarians and diatoms, and don't be fooled by the word eukaryote. They are still unicellular microorganisms, but they do secrete a silica shell or test, which is pictured here to the right. And despite their tiny size, they contribute incredible amounts of silica to the sea floor. In terms of their environment, they inhabit surface waters, and in the case of diatoms, they must live in the euphotic zone to get enough sunlight because diatoms photosynthesize. And in terms of their sheer abundance, for example, radiolarian oozes, as they're called, can occur below zones of high productivity and contain up to 100,000 shells per gram of sediment. However, diatoms might even be more impressive than this. Diatoms account for 40% of primary productivity in the oceans and heavily control global nutrient cycling. And in highly productive water, diatom shells can accumulate in enormous numbers to produce what's called diatomite in the rock record. We can see this incredible deposit of diatomite over here. This is just one example of many in the rock record where diatoms have been so accumulated that they form these crazy enormous deposits of all of their shells. But it's interesting that radiolarians and diatoms produce silica shells, since it takes a lot of energy to produce these types of shells, especially since it's not necessarily an energetically favorable process in the ocean. The ocean doesn't contain that much silica that it would be favorable for them to produce silica shells. We'll talk in the next video about how calcite shells can be produced because there's an abundance of calcium and carbonate in the ocean. But regarding silica, it's interesting that these guys actually evolved this ability. So let's talk a little bit about how they do it, and then we'll talk about the speculations as to why they use silica rather than a different material. So in the case of diatoms, they have a shell or fresh jewel that consists of two valves. New valves are formed during cell division, and this process begins in a compartment in their cell called the STV, which stands for the silica depositing vesicle. So pretty straightforward there. This vesicle will act as their locus of mineralization, like we mentioned earlier in the general process of controlled biomineralization. First, they pump silicic acid into their cell and transport it to the STV using specific transport proteins. They continue to do this until silica concentrations in their STV become supersaturated. Silica monomers then begin to polymerize into silica polymers, which then eventually grow into nanocolloids, and these colloids begin to adsorb to the interface of the SDV. And the SDV membrane, as a membrane-bound vesicle, is called the silicolemma. I hope I'm saying that right, but I don't know if there'd be any other way to say that. And a really cool thing about this process is that the silica binds so strongly to the silicolemma that only HF, hydrogen fluoride, guys, would be able to release the silica from this tight bond that it has formed. Even more impressive is that after this adsorption has occurred, the mineralization of silica continues at a rate 10 to the 6th times greater than abiotic supersaturated silica precipitation would occur. And if you're not aware, 10 to the 6th is 1 million. 1 million times faster than abiotic silica precipitation, even in supersaturated conditions. Anyway, this mineralization process occurs from the outer edge to the center of the SDV. The SDV then increases in size until the valve is completed. And then once it's completed, a new plasma membrane forms behind it, and the old plasma membrane and SDV membrane act as an organic casing that prevent the dissolution of the silicious valve in undersaturated waters, because like we mentioned, marine conditions are not supersaturated with silica. So if this valve had just been released into the environment and not protected by that organic layer, it probably would dissolve. For example, once the organism dies and that membrane is degraded, the silica shell rapidly dissolves. In most cases, there are definitely some exceptions where the silica will be protected and you'll get silica deposition and preservation in the rock record. But in most cases, it does redissolve and it's recycled back into the water column. And then it quickly reprecipitates because all of these organisms out there are taking whatever silica is in that water and using it for their shell formation, as we just seen. But the reason why they use silica rather than a different material is currently unknown. It's speculated, though, that these organisms evolved this ability because they evolved in more silica-rich oceans, and then it just stuck because having a silica shell is really protective and has a lot of benefits, and therefore got passed down generation to generation and has remained in the evolutionary line of such organisms. Because you can probably imagine that having a silica shell is much more protective than having just an organic layer of protection or even a calcite shell. Silica is harder than calcite. But it's also speculated that the silica might buffer the pH, enabling the conversion of bicarbonate to CO2, which is useful for photosynthesis for organisms like diatoms that need to photosynthesize. So there are multiple speculations as to why this property evolved in the first place and why it stuck in the evolutionary line of these organisms, but it's still a pretty open question. So if you're interested in it, I encourage you all to look further into it and make your own conclusions or even go into this for your research. And with that, that is all I have for this video. We will be talking in the next video, the part 5 biomineralization video, about more biologically controlled biomineralization processes, including calcite, which is a really awesome one because you guys probably know a lot of really cool organisms that form calcite shells or skeletons or tests. And I'm really excited to share with you how that all works. And in the following video, we'll talk about microbial weathering. So silicate weathering, carbonate weathering, soil formation, and how weathering has to do with and affects global climate. And last, as always, the major reference I'm using to make this video in particular is the Introduction to Geomicrobiology by Kurt Kahnhauser. And this is linked in my description if you want to check it out. I'm also using a few other minor references that I'm including in my description if you want to check those out as well as image sources and everything else you can find in my description below. And while you're down there, comment down below what, in your opinion, is the coolest biomineral that we went over today. Like I said, magnetite and greigite were so, so cool, but in my opinion, the amorphous silica formers are amazing. I don't know, I hedge between magnetite and the silica. I mean, the magnetite is literally magnetic, so that's really cool. And I like that both are kind of associated with mysteries because we're still not certain why they need the magnetic abilities, especially at the equator, and why other organisms don't have them. And we're also still not fully certain why the silica producers produce silica and not something easier to precipitate. So I love that they're associated with uncertainties and they open these doors to more research opportunities, which is really, really cool. So go check those out and let me know in the comments which your favorite or most intriguing is to you. And I hope to see you guys in the upcoming videos. Bye guys. And before you guys call me nerdy for wearing an isotopes hat, joke's on you because this is actually a baseball team in New Mexico. But, you know, that's not necessarily the reason I bought it.